Morning, everyone. My name's Nate. I'm going to be reading from Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 6 this morning. And God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven, above or on the earth, beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments." This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. So today we get to start the second week of our Ten Commandments series. And as we do so, I want to remind you what the Ten Commandments are and why they matter to us. So last week we looked at the Ten Commandments and we saw first and foremost that the Ten Commandments are the words of God. This is a unique time where the presence of God descended upon Mount Sinai. Moses went up to the mountain to meet with God. And it seems, as far as we can tell, that God spoke to Moses audibly. Now, for us as believers in Jesus Christ, it should be true of everyone everywhere, but it's certainly true of us. When God speaks, we should listen. And so here we are in the midst of the Ten Commandments. We hear the voice of God speaking to us. And so number one reason we care about the Ten Commandments, why they matter to us, even though we're a new covenant people, is because of the words of God. The second thing I want you to know about the Ten Commandments is they do not save us. We don't get to God by, you know, at least keeping 70%. I got 7 out of 10. I think that's, you know, still passing grades. Then maybe God will accept me. That's not how this works at all. As a matter of fact, every single one of us has failed. We have sinned. If you look at the commandments, you've broken most, if not all of them. And we are saved by the grace of Jesus Christ through faith in him and his work. So Jesus, the Son of God, was sent to earth. He lived a perfect, sinless life and then went to the cross for us. He offered his life as an atoning sacrifice for ours. So Jesus died that we might live. The Ten Commandments do not save us. They're not the standard by which we earn our way to God. Really, if anything, they were here to point us toward God and our need for a Savior. So Ten Commandments are the words of God. They do not save us. They're not the path to salvation. But here's the beautiful part. The Ten Commandments, they show us who God is. The law is a reflection of the lawgiver. And so if you want to know some of the nature and character of God, we see it revealed through the Ten Commandments. We see the faithfulness of God to his covenants. When he tells us not to commit adultery, we're reminded that he is a covenant-keeping God who never fails to keep his covenants with us, even though we have all gone astray. We've all sinned against God. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, he keeps his covenant with us. Okay? So they're the words of God. Excuse me. They are not the path of salvation. They show us who God is. And the fourth thing they do is they keep us free. So in the context that God is delivering the Ten Commandments to Moses on the top of the mountain, he's just led his people out of slavery in Egypt. Like this powerful movement of God through plagues and all these things, God brought Pharaoh to his knees. He released the Israelites who were his slaves there in Egypt. He brought them across the sea on dry land. He's led them out of slavery and into freedom. And God does the same for us. When we come to faith in Jesus Christ, we who were once enslaved to sin are now set free, slaves to righteousness now, no longer slaves to sin. And what the commandments do for us, the teachings of Jesus, not just these Ten Commandments, they serve as like guardrails for our lives. So as believers and followers of Jesus, so that we don't go off the cliff again into the slavery of sin, but instead we walk the path that God would ultimately want us to walk. This is worship is the reason we would keep these, okay? Now, last week we saw that basically God said, "I am the Lord your God." He tells us his name, "I am Yahweh." And with that proclamation, we see that he is the supreme God of the universe, that he is wholly other than us, that God went ahead and broke all the laws of science and physics, the things that we know. He made something out of nothing. He made life out of non-life. God is wholly other than us. Everything you've ever known and seen, every glimmer of beauty was a reflection of God. The intricacy, the complexity of creation is a tiny little reflection of his knowledge, of his power, of his creative abilities. And so God is wholly other than us. He spoke all that we know and see into existence. He knit us together in our mother's womb. Like, God is responsible for all of this. I am the Lord. He said, I'm not just Yahweh, I'm Elohim. I'm the Lord, your God. I'm the God who knows you. The God who sees you in your difficult moments when you feel like no one else knows and you're all alone. God sees you. And God is a God who hears his people. Just as the Israelites, while they were enslaved to Egypt, they cried out to God and he heard them and acted on their behalf. Our God is a God who hears his people. And he acts on our behalf, this great, big, powerful God, the God of all gods, the King of all kings, is also our Heavenly Father who cares for us. I don't know what it is that you might be facing today, the thing that you might be concerned about and worried about that might be weighing heavily on you. I want you to know that God has got this. He sees you. He knows what you're going through. He hears you, and he works on our behalf. Now, today, we're going to look at the second commandment. It's quite a bit like the first. You've probably heard this. It may be the one that comes to mind when you think about the Ten Commandments, but here's what he says in verse 4. He says, you shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. So we get a little more information here in this command than we do in the others, right? God is sharing quite a lot with us. And it begins with something that may seem peculiar to you and I. He says, you shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of things, you know, in heaven or on earth or even, you know, under the earth. Don't make carved images. Now, it may seem like a really foolish thing. I mean, if you have one, I'm not trying to insult you, for us to carve an idol, you know, make a shrine and bow down and worship to it. I mean, you think about it, like, you took that hunk of wood and you carved out all the pieces. You know it's just wood. You know that it's not a living thing. It's not, you know, powerful. It doesn't have any control. It doesn't hear you. It doesn't see you. It doesn't know you. It's dead. It's a hunk of wood, right? It might seem foolish, but what God has done in his creation, the people whom he has formed, he made us in his image. God created us to know him, to worship him, to walk with him. You and I were created for worship. And here's what I want to tell you. You may not believe this, but it's ultimately true. If we do not give our lives to the worship of God, if we don't bow down and serve him, we will give our lives to the worship of something else. And maybe without even realizing, we will be bowing down and worshiping something other than God. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, it actually mentions this kind of in passing. He mentions that God has put eternity into man's heart. Now, I'm a thinker, you know, I like to understand things, but I really struggle with eternity. Like, I want to be able to kind of grasp what eternity is. And so, if you put it in terms of money, can y'all imagine how much money $1 million is? Like, 1 million, I've never taken the time to count that high. I tried a few times in the car as a kid, never made it that far, but $1 million, that's a lot of money. But then you think about $1 billion, and that's 1,000 million, and so that's a whole lot more money. And then you think of trillions of dollars, the kind of money our government spends, right? Like, that's beyond what I can fathom. And to think that $1 trillion would be a tiny thing compared to the number of years in the span of eternity. And to think about a God who has always existed, no beginning and no end, like, it blows my mind, right? There's something there that is far beyond me. The writer of Ecclesiastes is saying he put eternity in the hearts of men, but we can't understand eternity. Like, we can't fathom how big that is. And what he's telling us is that God, he wrote into creation, he put within us this understanding that there is something greater out there, that there is something transcendent out there in the world, and we should be compelled to worship that thing. That God made us to know him and to love him, to walk with him. God made us for a relationship with him. And if we aren't worshiping God, we'll seek something else to walk with, to bow down to, and ultimately to serve. Here's what kind of happens, and Augustine talks about this. It's a sad state for men. When we don't know God, what ultimately will happen, and you've probably seen this pattern in the lives of people you know, people will go from thing to thing and hobby to hobby, house to house, relationship to relationship, job to job, experience to experience, and always feeling a sense of emptiness, right? They're always seeking something greater, the thing that will ultimately satisfy them, the thing that will ultimately be transcendent, that will bring meaning and kind of completion to their life. And I want you to know that one thing is God. And apart from God, we spend our lives chasing after these things that will never ultimately satisfy us. The Westminster Shorter Catechism, if you're into that sort of thing, asks the question, what is the chief end of man? What is our purpose? Why are we really here? And the answer is, it says, the chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. You and I were created to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. Again, if we don't worship the one true God, we will worship something else. Even if that something happens to be a carved image, something made out of wood or fashioned out of metal, and we'll find ourselves bowing down to those things, as foolish as it seems, because we were made to worship. I want you to know everyone worships. Atheists worship, agnostics worship, certainly believers worship. Democrats and Republicans sometimes worship their party or the president, right? They'll turn to something other than God because we think this is what's going to make us whole. Or in a thousand different ways, we will worship something. It's the fundamental drive of our lives. So as God begins giving us this commandment, it's assumed here that we will worship something. What he commands then is that we don't make for ourselves some sort of graven image, a carved idol. We don't fashion a calf out of gold. That's what the Israelites did just a little bit later in Exodus, right? Moses was taking too long on top of the mountain. They're like, we got to worship something. So they throw in all their jewelry and ask Aaron to make a golden calf, and they bow down and worship it. And obviously, that was offensive toward God. And the things that we tend to worship, they also offend the heart of God. We're going to see a little bit later just how severely our worship of other things offends the holy God of the universe. So the first thing that I want to say, want you to see today, is that you and I, we were made to worship. The second part that I want to emphasize here is that God is worthy of our worship. The Israelites did it with a golden calf. When Paul came into Athens, and we saw this in Acts, he comes into the city and he looks around, and there are temples, and there are shrines. There's a God for just about everything. And he walks into the city, and kind of the Areopagus, where he's going to speak to the people. And he said, you know, I see that you're very religious. And that's true of all of us, right? We're very religious. We are seeking after something. I see that you're very religious. There's even an inscription to an unknown God. Can I tell you who that unknown God is? He begins to describe this in Acts chapter 17, beginning in verse 24. He said, the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, he doesn't live in temples made by man. He's not served by human hands as though he needed anything, right? God is wholly independent and self-sufficient, self-sustaining. Since he himself gives life to all mankind, life and breath and everything, and he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on the face of the earth, having determined the allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward Him and find Him. Yet He is actually not far from each one of us. There's a whole lot said there, right? We see God who's wholly independent, self-sufficient, self-sustaining, and then all of creation whom God has to sustain. God created everything and ultimately sustains it. He's given us life. He's given us breath. He's determined when we're going to live and where we're going to live. And God is determined that we should seek Him. You and I were made for worship, and He alone is the one who is worthy of that worship. The trouble with worshiping any other thing is it can never deliver what it promises. Other things are just like those carved idols. They're empty, they're dead, they're worthless, lifeless, powerless things. So we should worship the one true God. A couple of experiences I've had. One, I got to go to China a few years ago, and we went to one of the temples. And It was sobering, heartbreaking in some ways, and in other ways, you kind of wanted to. It was just surprising. You almost wanted to laugh. I don't want to be disrespectful toward any, you know, other people, but as we're there, we go into this temple, and they have this big metal object. It's like a trough, and then it had like a big piece of metal above, and in that trough, they would light fireworks to try to awaken the gods so that they might hear their prayers. And so they would light these things off, right? And it's really loud. It's supposed to reverberate. That's what it's made to do. And then they would trade real money for fake money. And they would go to this little stand and, you know, they'd buy this fake money. And they would go up to this temple where these false gods were. By the way, they're paper mache, y'all. And they would bring offerings of food and fruit. And this paper money, they would light it on fire. And these people, with their whole hearts, were worshiping these gods that were paper mache. They were empty. And it was heartbreaking to see that people would give their money and their time and their worship to something that was literally paper mache. Somebody made that, you know? Like, I did that in junior high, and yet they're worshiping. And it seems so foolish. And then I got a chance several years ago to go to Rome, and we spent time at the Vatican and St. Peter's Basilica. It's overwhelmingly beautiful and just amazing to see. But also heartbreaking at the same time. I saw people weep tears at the tombs of dead popes. They were praying and reaching their hands out to these relics that were supposed to be like somehow connected to the saints over the years. And they're empty. None of those things are God. And I use those as illustrations because it's also true of us. The things that we would worship, and maybe we roll our eyes about paper mache gods or, you know, a relic or, you know, a dead person's grave, but we do it too. And in the same way that they're empty and lifeless and powerless and can give nothing back in return, every other thing we would seek as an idol can give nothing back in return. We were made to worship, and God alone is worthy of our worship. Of our whole life, not kind of half-hearted worship, but our whole, of our gratitude and our affections and our focus and our thoughts. Like, God is worthy of all of that. That's who He is. We shouldn't bow down or serve any other thing. So, we were made to worship. God is worthy of our worship. And then the next piece here is really, really significant, and I hope you feel the weight of this in your life. There in verse 5, He says, "You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord," He's about to tell us who He is, and it's important that we understand this. "I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." What does this mean? Because it's important that we get this right, to understand who God is. We know that He's perfect in all of His ways. You know, is this jealousy like maybe what we've experienced in our life where she's cuter and he's richer or more talented and we're kind of jealous of what they have? Is that what this jealousy is? Ultimately, if you've ever listened to Oprah, this was her understanding of God's jealousy. She tells a story. She was a young girl, I believe, going to a Baptist church, and she hears the pastor talking about the jealousy of God, and she thinks, "Why in the world would I serve a God who's jealous of me? Like, must not be a very big God." I would submit to you, she might have should have submitted her understanding of what jealousy is. It's not merely God's wishing that He had something that we have. He made us, right? He has far more than we have. He doesn't have a rival. He doesn't have need of anybody. He's greater than all. So it's not kind of our standard dictionary.com definition of jealousy. I'll give you those just so you can kind of hear them. The first is a feeling of resentment against someone because of that person's success or their advantages. Because they have more followers or more fame or more money or whatever it is that we might want. That's not who God is. He doesn't have a rival. He owns it all. He's wholly other than us and greater in every way. So that's not who God is. What about the jealousy for something that's yours? Fellas, you ever felt this, right? You're in high school and you're dating the most beautiful girl you thought you'd ever seen, and you had these plans, you're going to spend your whole life together, and then you see her talking to another dude. You feel this jealousy for what's yours, right? That's kind of significant. That's a really powerful emotion that we feel. Is that what God was ultimately feeling? Listen, I would want you to know that God is not fearful, and God is not insecure of what He might lose, right? God is all-knowing and all-powerful. powerful. So what is this jealousy of God? What can we understand this to mean? Because it's important, right? Because there's really significant weight that he adds to the end of this for the consequences when God is jealous of us. I think the best definition I found is J.I. Packer in his book, Knowing God, says that God's jealousy is his holiness reacting to evil in a way that is morally right and precious. It's God reacting to evil in a way that is morally right and ultimately precious. It is a praiseworthy zeal on his part to preserve something supremely precious. Charles Spurgeon said this. He said, "Since he is the only God, the creator of heaven and earth, he cannot endure that any creature of his own hands or fiction of a creature's imagination should be thrust into his throne and made to wear his crown." Augustine went on to tell us that without God as our supreme love, we will experience a profound and irresolvable restlessness. He would argue that God's jealousy is a function of his love for us, that we will find the one true love that our hearts desperately long for, the one who can satisfy our souls, the one who is worthy of all of our glory and honor and praise. And his jealousy is that we don't get that wrong. So that we don't spend our lives wandering from thing to thing and hobby to hobby and person to person, seeking after the thing that will ultimately satisfy the deepest longings of our souls. But we'll find God. We won't give our affections and worship to something inferior, a created thing of God. But we will give our affections to our Creator. We were made by God and for His glory. Again, ultimately, God's jealousy is a function of his own glory and of his love for us. He alone is worthy, and only he can satisfy us. Apart from God, we will never be at rest. Remember Jesus speaking, teaching throughout the New Testament, most clearly this passage. He looks at people. Maybe it was Judaism and the sacrificial system. Maybe he had the Gentiles in mind with the dozens of gods. He says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. You're exhausted with all the seeking, striving for things and never finding satisfaction. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest for your souls." This jealousy is not one of God's insecurity or fear. It's not God wanting something that we have. He's greater than us. It's ultimately God wanting us to be rightly aligned with him. He is God, and we are his worshipers, his people. He created this by him and for him and for his glory. This is the right aligning of our lives. Now, there are some really significant consequences, and I want to spend some time with this because oftentimes our modern perspectives of God is he's like the big cuddly teddy bear, right? God is just love, and he loves me and accepts me and doesn't really have any, standards for my life. Whoever I am, that's who God is. But God is really clear here. When we give our worship to another, it provokes him to jealousy. Look what it says here. "For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me." Just so you know, to worship something other than God isn't indifference toward him. It is hatred toward God. That's how God sees it. It's really significant. It's really substantial. But he says of his jealousy that he will visit the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation. So you kind of take four generations, you got, you and your children, your grandchildren, and even to your great-grandchildren. Most scholars I read would say that this kind of reflects the total number of generations that you could see in your life. And what you would know is that your sin didn't just affect you, but your sin affected your children and their children and their children, that the jealousy of God is profound, that there will be punishment for worshiping someone other than God. And this is, again, really significant. And you would have to watch that throughout all of your days as you see that your rebellion had consequences, not just for you, but your children and on down to your great-grandchildren. It's a really big deal. And to be honest with you, every one of us has rebelled against God. This is what we deserve. We deserve to watch others suffer, those who we care about the most, because of our sin. And the good news is for us, because of Jesus Christ, because of his work on our behalf, because of the cross, our sins aren't counted against us. But rather, Jesus bore the full punishment for sin there on the cross, and God credited to us that righteous life of Jesus. So as believers in Jesus Christ, we don't have to fear punishment, but we shouldn't underestimate how significantly God takes our rebellion. Now, here's the other side of this coin, because he goes on. He says, but showing steadfast love to thousands, this is inferred here, thousands of generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You know that loving God and keeping his commandments go hand in hand. When we love him, when we recognize that he's God, that his ways are higher, his thoughts are higher, he's perfect, we automatically obey him. Rather than obeying ourselves or our own desires, our own thoughts, we obey God. And that demonstrates our love for him. And you should see that his goodness and his love far outweighs his jealous punishment for us. That God is so good that even for people who have sinned against him, he doesn't count our sins against us because of the work of Jesus. But instead, he credits to us that righteous life, and we should have the expectation of his love. Now, I've spent quite a bit of time kind of breaking down this text. And I don't have time to unpack every idol that might be present in your life. It might be an athlete or an entertainer or, you know, something that you've elevated in your life in some way. But I want to speak to the one God that I believe that gets elevated more than any other in our culture. And I would even say, even in our church, it's been true of me. And that is the God of self. That while we don't, you know, carve things out of wood and maybe fashion a molten metal into some sort of idol, the graven image that we have a tendency to worship is the one that we see in the mirror. That the voice that we tend to listen to is the voice of ourself. The God of self is all about me. It affirms our every belief, right? Yeah, I kind of like my thoughts. I think they're really smart, or else I wouldn't hold to those beliefs, right? It affirms the values that we hold, the ethics that we prefer. Y'all, we live in a culture that really believes that we can define our own truth, right? And in some small way, I believe that slips into the hearts of believers if we're not really careful. That rather than looking to God to know what's true, we look in the mirror, we look to our own thoughts, our own ideas, and we ask, what is true, right? What do we believe? We believe we can have our own truth. And we'd be foolish to think it's not happening in the church. The God of self would look to the scriptures and see what the Word of God teaches, and then decide that it can't be true, that God must have been mistaken, the culture must have shifted, that we must be misinterpreting when God's values disagree with ours. It's idolatry. It's saying that we know better than God, and God takes that very seriously with us. The God of self means that that which pleases us is deemed good, and that which is displeasing is deemed bad. The God of self says we get to define what is good and what is true and what is righteous. Anything and everything that disagrees with us must be wrong. Right? And what we're ultimately doing is making gods in our own image that mimic back to us our priorities and our beliefs and our values, our thoughts. And it should be no surprise that in the midst of a society that's profoundly divided because everyone has their own thoughts, right, that Christianity hasn't stood out, but rather we're often in the fray, casting the same insults over political discussions or, you know, having the same disagreement among ourselves over things. It's rather than bowing before God and him as true, the one true God, rather than serving him with our whole hearts, we've bowed before our own ideas and we fight for them as if they're God's truth. The God of self is all about our happiness and fulfillment. And the problem with that is that it can provide neither. That God is dead. It can't provide anything. It's powerless. The God of self is no more than a carved image or a cast idol, no more powerful than a chunk of wood or metal. It's just as empty. God, in his goodness to us, met with Moses on the top of the mountain, and he said, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything in heaven above or on the earth or under the earth. For I, the Lord, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments." We were made to worship, and God alone is worthy of that worship. That God who knows you and sees you is jealous for your worship, for his own glory, and because he loves you and wants you to find the ultimate thing that will satisfy the deepest longings of your souls. Would you bow with me? Father, we thank you for your word that teaches us. We thank you, God, that you're a God who has revealed yourself. We don't have to guess about who you are. We know your name and in your word. You reveal to us your character. That yes, you're a God who is passionate about sin. That there is a righteous judgment against sin. And yet you are a God whose steadfast love is shown to a thousand generations of those who love you. God, we thank you that you're a God who saw us in all of our sin and chose to go to the cross to die, enduring the punishment that we deserved, dying on that cross that we might find life. And so, Lord, it's my prayer that as your people gathered in this place who call ourselves believers or Christians, God, that we would humble ourselves, we would bow before you and serve you only, that our lives would be given to your worship and to none other. We live lives of love for you and obedience to your commands. God, you are worthy. We praise you for your goodness and your perfection and for your honor. We praise you in Jesus' name, for you are holy. Amen.